Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at loveisrael.org. That's one word, loveisrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
It is an absolute necessity that we understand who Messiah is. And not just his name, but his character. And what I'm speaking about is his divinity. If you believe in a Savior, in a Messiah, in a Christ that is not divine, well, you're not believing in the biblical Messiah. You don't know the scriptural Yeshua. Well, we've been studying in the book of Daniel, and now we're coming to a very important messianic prophecy, one that gives us fact concerning the divinity of Messiah. So if you are under a teaching where your leader is saying, well, Yeshua, he's Messiah, but we don't believe that he is God among us, that he is divine, that he is the only begotten Son of God the Father, well, you are hearing false teaching. And we're going to demonstrate that without any doubt from the Old Testament. Well, take out your Bible and look with me to the book of Daniel, chapter 7. We've been speaking about prophecy as we began chapter 7. We've seen that there are empires in the past, but there's one that's different from all the rest. And this empire that Daniel begins to speak of, it is the empire that the Antichrist is going to rule over in the last days. And it's going to be God's judgment. And here's the key. His judgment, God the Father's judgment, is going to be poured out in this world by the Lamb. That is, by Messiah. And therefore, Daniel wants us to understand who Messiah is. So as I said, look with me to the seventh chapter of the book of Daniel. We're going to begin in verse 13 in a very key passage. Daniel 7 and verse 13, he's having a vision. Remember, he had a dream and also night visions. And that's in the plural. And the reason why that's important is because he had several visions, and this is one of them. Verse 13, I was looking at these night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven came one who was similar to the Son of Man. Now, this is one of the reasons why Yeshua, and I'm speaking about Jesus, of course, why he's called the Son of Man. It is a prophetic term. Not only is Daniel called the Son of Man, but we also see that Ezekiel was called the Son of Man. And the reason why this term appears here, and it also, as in this passage, relates to Yeshua himself, is because in these two prophecies, Ezekiel and Daniel, we're talking about the glory of heaven coming to earth. What does that mean? How can we describe that? What's another word that we can relate that, the glory of heaven coming to earth? Very simply, the establishment of the kingdom of God. And Messiah, he is the key. He is the one who is going to establish the kingdom of God. But notice what it says here. Now, this passage, for example, is used in the book of Revelation, chapter 1. And in chapter 1 of the book of Revelation, we see a description of Yeshua. Now, this is important. The entire book of Revelation is to give us a better understanding of the identity of Yeshua. And it uses this scripture verbatimly. And what it says is, and how it's usually understood, is Messiah is coming from the heavens in the clouds to earth, and he's going to do that. I'm not saying he's not. He's going to. Other scripture tells us this. But this passage isn't about his second coming, when he will judge this empire. This prophetic passage, this messianic prophecy is to teach us the identity of Yeshua. Why do I say that? Look at verse 13. I was looking at the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven came one looking like the Son of Man. And he came unto the Ancient of Days. Who's that? The Ancient of Days is God the Father. And he was brought before him. So now we see something. This isn't about his second coming, but it's used to say that Yeshua, the Son of Man, was brought before the Ancient of Days, God the Father. And what was the purpose of this meeting? What was going to take place? Well, look now to verse 14. We find a rule. This is a government or a kingdom, an honor, and then another word for a rule or kingdom was given to him. So here at this time, when God the Son comes before God the Father, it was for the purpose for him to inherit a kingdom, to inherit glory, to inherit honor. And it also tells us, look at the second half of verse 14, and all peoples, nations, and languages will do something, will worship him. Now, most Bibles, they simply say, will serve him. But we need to pay very close to this phrase, will worship him. And why do I translate it, will worship him, instead of serve him? Well, this is when things get very interesting, and we need to pause and go slow, because if we misunderstand this, we're going to miss out on an important biblical truth, what's foundational in this messianic prophecy. Now, Daniel chapter 7, in fact, much of the chapters that we've been looking at, the first half of the book of Daniel, most is written not in Hebrew, but in Aramaic. And this passage, this chapter is as well Aramaic. Why is that important? Because the words are different from Hebrew. If in Hebrew this was written, we would have the word lavod. Lavod means to serve, to work, or to worship. All of those terms are found as a proper description or definition for the Hebrew word la'avod. So if it was Hebrew, we could not be dogmatic and say, all people, nations, and languages will worship him. We could have to say, would serve him. And this doesn't have religious connotations to it necessarily. But again, God in his providence, God in his perfect knowledge, inspired Daniel to write this in Aramaic. And when we come to Aramaic, we find the word pe, lamed, chet, those three letters. And whenever that word, palach, is used in the book of Daniel, it is always being referred to worship, using something in a spiritual overtone. It is never used for someone serving another like an employee serves an employer, like a servant serves his master, like subjects serve a king. This word, pe lamed chet, is always used in regard to worship. Whether it's false worship or true worship, it always has a worship or a ritualistic significance to it. So when we look at Daniel chapter 7, verse 14, where it says, and all peoples and nations and languages, it must be translated, worship him. And this speaks to his divinity. And we find that his kingdom will be an everlasting kingdom, and his rule will be never removed from him. It will not end. So this passage is simply saying the kingdom is a kingdom and uses the word for a regime. His regime is an eternal one that will not be removed, and his kingdom will not bring about an end, will not end. So we're talking about the kingdom of Messiah. Well, let's press on to verse 15. And I, Daniel, was grieved in my spirit, and in the midst of me, he says, I was in turmoil, because of these visions of the night. They were disturbing me. Now, he's speaking about these former ones, of these empires, especially this last one that was blasphemous. Verse 16, and I approach one of the ones standing, and who would that be? Well, he's receiving a heavenly vision, and most scholars, in fact, all that I've read, are speaking about these ones standing here as angels. So he approached one of the ones standing, that is an angel, and he says, the truth, meaning the truth of this matter, I desired from him concerning all of this. And he said to me that he will make known to me the interpretation of these things. Verse 17. And these great beasts, what are we speaking about? Empires, these great empires, he says, were four. Now here again, why tell us four? Four is a global number. These empires, for the most part, ruled over the world, much of it. But the final one that we'll talk about in the weeks to come, this final one will indeed be a global empire. And who's going to be the one that rules over that? The answer is the Antichrist. Once more, verse 17. And these great beasts, they are four. They are four kingdoms that will rise up in the world. Verse 8. And the saints of the Most High. Now it's the holy ones. And there is a debate. Who are we speaking about here? Well, I believe we're going to find out. In the book of Revelation, we're speaking about believers. And I can prove that in a moment, but let's just continue on in verse 8. And the saints of the Most High, they will receive a kingdom, and they will become strong in this kingdom forever and ever and ever. So who's going to be in that kingdom forever and ever? Believers. Verse 19. And then as I was seeking the truth concerning the fourth beast. Now remember, this fourth beast was unique than all the ones that preceded it. And what we're going to have to understand is that Daniel's seeing this fourth beast in a series of time allotments, period of time. And that should not surprise us. Why? Well, let's pause for a moment and learn a very important biblical truth. When we go, for example, to the book of Revelation chapter 17, and when we study the book of Revelation, we talked about this. In the book of Revelation chapter 17 that was written by John, John sees a beast with seven heads. And these seven heads represent 10 kingdoms or 10 empires. And they're all interrelated, meaning they all had something in common. And John, in Revelation chapter 17, he says something. He receives an information, revelation from the angel who is speaking to him. And he says concerning these seven empires, he says five of them have fallen, meaning they've come and they're no more. Who would that be? Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, the fourth is the Medes and the Persians, and the fifth would be Greece. So let's say it again. First, Egypt, the second is Assyria, the third is Babylon, the fourth are the Medes and the Persians, and the fifth would be the Greek Empire. These in John's days had come and gone. That's why he says five were and they have fallen. And then he says one is. Who would that be? Well, the sixth one would simply be Rome. Now, we're going to see something. There is also a seventh one. And we're told that there's seven in total. But here's the problem. In the midst of Revelation 17, we are told that there's also, and this is new revelation, this is surprising, there's also an eighth, which is the final, and he's from the seventh. Now, if we do a good job of study, we find something. We find that Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, and the Medes and the Persians, all of those were either in Africa or in the Middle East. It's only when you get to the fifth one, Greece, and the sixth one, Rome, that we find there's an emphasis on where? On Europe. And we find that there's a seventh and then an eighth. So how many are there from Europe? The answer is four. And this is very important because the last four are all based in Europe. We need to remember that. Whether it's Greece or Rome or the seventh one or the final one, they're all based in Europe. This is important. It can all be substantiated as we're going to do in the weeks to come. Now, this is important because go back to what we're looking at in verse 17. These beasts, they are four, and they're four kingdoms that will be established in the earth. And what is their purpose? Their purpose is, in a unique way, to do something. We're going to find that they are in opposition to who? The saints of the Most High. Look at verse 8. And the saints of the Most High, they will receive a kingdom. They will become strong in that kingdom, and that kingdom is going to be forever and ever. What does he do here? Verse 8 is important because it is a summary statement for the purpose of encouragement. It's the same way that we looked at earlier on in Daniel chapter 7, when we saw that God was going to take his seat, thrones were going to be established, and judgment was going to be made, and that evil empire, that blasphemous empire, is going to be destroyed. So God has a habit of giving us good news before the bad news. Why? To encourage us, to tell us we are going to be victorious. And remember verse 8, because what is it emphasizing? We're going to be the ones who receive that kingdom. We're going to be strong, meaning when we come into that kingdom, we're going to be transformed, and that kingdom is going to have no end. Now look, if you would, to verse 19. I think I said verse 8, verse 18. Now we're ready for verse 19. We read here, "And I was seeking the truth concerning the fourth beast that was different," and this is important, "different from all the rest. He was exceedingly fearful, and we find that he had teeth of iron and claws of copper, and he was devouring and smashing all that remained." Verse 20. "And concerning his 10 horns that were in his head, and the horn, another horn that sprouted up," we find here that three other horns were consumed because of him. So we've already told this, and here's a purpose. There's a false holiness. The number 10 speaks of completion, that which is in its entirety. So it has 10 horns. It's complete. Its kingdom is full. It's powerful. It is all-encompassing. But then when it says this final horn, this final leader, we're speaking about the Antichrist. He is going to spring forth. And by the way, this is from the word samach, which means to spring forward. And that word is oftentimes used in regard to Messiah, especially, for example, in the book of Zechariah. He's called the samach, which is the branch from the tree of Jesse, meaning from the house of Judah. And we're talking about the household of David. So look again, as he was seeking to understand this vision, he saw this beast that was different from all the rest. It was exceedingly terrible. It had teeth of iron, claws of copper, and he was devouring and smashing all that remained. Verse 20. Then it speaks about these 10 horns, and when this final one, this leader, comes up, he's going to remove three of them. And then look at the end of verse 20. "And to this horn there were eyes and a mouth speaking great things," meaning blasphemous things. And this great vision, it says here, that's vision was greater than his vision, was greater than his friends, meaning this empire was going to be more significant, of greater power than the ones that preceded it. Now look to verse 21. Verse 21 is very important. It has significant theological implications. Notice what it says. We read, "And I was looking, behold, this horn made war with who? The saints." Now, are they really believers? Because some people, they'll say, oh no, the Antichrist will never be manifested until the church is removed. That's what most people believe. There's a problem with that. We find that here, if indeed saints meaning believers, we find that the Antichrist, this horn, is making a war with believers. So that is theological problematic if you believe that before the Antichrist comes on the scene, the church is raptured up. So they will say very dogmatically that this has to be speaking about Old Testament saints. Well, is it? Let's look at Revelation chapter 13, because as I said, Revelation 13 parallels. Revelation 13 is a great commentary that helps us understand Daniel chapter 7. So look with me, Revelation chapter 13, and notice what's happening here. We see that Revelation 13 is a prophecy about an empire that's going to rise up out of chaos, meaning out of the sea, when there's great instability. And in order to understand our studies, you need to realize that instability in the last days is going to be the key fact that brings about this evil empire. And notice what it says in Revelation chapter 13. I want you to go down to verse 8. Revelation 13, verse 8 says, "And all the dwellers of the earth," now this is those who have no connection with the kingdom of God, "they are going to worship the beasts whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb." And notice what it says here, "this one who's going to be slain from the foundations of the earth." And who are we talking about here? Well, go to the previous verse, verse 7. "And it was given to" who? This evil empire, "to make war with the saints and to overcome them." Now, I read verse 8 first, because verse 8 is clear speaking about the ones who are saved, the ones whose names are written in the Lamb's book of life, believers. And then something else that helps us understand that it's speaking about the church, look at verse 9. We're told that this beast is going to make war with the saints and overcomes them. That is, overcomes them in the flesh. He's going to have a temporary victory, just like what? Just like Satan thought he had a temporary victory at the cross. Messiah was put to death. He laid down his life. No one took it from him, but he was put to death. And the enemy thought that meant victory, when in actuality, it meant their defeat. Same thing here. Now, why can I be so sure that we're speaking about the church and not Old Testament saints? Here's the reason. Verse 9. And verse 9, short verses, just says, "And he who has an ear, let him hear." Now, if you're a good student of the book of Revelation, you will recall that in Revelation chapters 2 and 3, there are seven messages to seven different churches. And it speaks to each one of these churches. At the end of its message, and the message is from Messiah, John gave it to the leader of each congregation, but the message originated with Yeshua. And he says at the end, "To him who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says." That expression, "to him who has an ear, let him hear," is always given to the church in the book of Revelation. And therefore, what we read here about this evil empire and the Antichrist making war with the saints and overcoming us temporarily, it is a message, because it says, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." It is a reference to the church. And this is very important that we see this. Well, let's go back to Daniel chapter 7. We read here where we left off. Look at verse 21. And I was looking, and behold, this horn made war with the saints and overcame them, until the Ancient of Days came and he judged their judgment of the saints of the Most High. Meaning this, this went on until God judged the judgment for us, meaning he gave us judgment. What is that? Vindication. Messiah is going to vindicate us. And we read here once more that the time will arrive that the saints will be strong. Where? In the kingdom. So our strength, our hope, our objective is not in this world. If we lose our life, so what? Because all the enemy can do is take away this physical shell. It can hurt us physically, emotionally, but it cannot affect the covenantal promises that we have from God. We can rest assured in Messiah, no matter what we are called to go through and suffer. And by the way, when Messiah says, take up your cross and follow me, it implies suffering. It implies cross death, cross shame. All these things we can experience upon the believers in the last day, but in the same way that Messiah was risen from the dead. He rose from the dead, but what's important is that he was raised from the dead by God his Father, meaning God acknowledged him. God raised him from the dead as a statement of acceptance. And in the same way, we can be assured that in the last days, no matter what we are called to endure, that there's going to be a war, that the enemy is going to wage against us first, then Israel second. But we can be assured that God, when he judges, we will receive our vindication, that we are going to be made victorious. So what happens to us in this age, physically, it's not of great concern, because flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. So we're going to see, as we continue on in this seventh chapter of the book of Daniel, we're going to see a message of hope. We're going to see truth in order that we can be prepared, and how significant it is to be prepared by the power of prayer. Well, I'll close with that until next week, and we continue on in Daniel chapter 7.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of loveisrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, loveisrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with him. Shalom from Israel.